So, very good afternoon to friends and colleagues, students and parents. Myself, Maheshwar Dwivedi, an associate professor in Mechanical Engineering Department at BML Gunjal University. I will like to introduce all my panelists today. With me today is Professor Nandita from the Humanities Department. Then we have Professor Anubhav Agarwal from Electronics and Computer Engineering Department. Professor Rajiv Day, also from Electronics and Computer Engineering Department. And Dr. Kiran Khattar from Computer Science and Engineering Department. And the last panelist is, last but not the least, is Professor Babu from Applied Science Department. So without wasting much time, let me first welcome you all to this webinar on virtual labs at conducted by BML Gunjal University. So as you may know, virtual labs is a concept of teaching laboratory content and also practice through the use of certain internet-based applications. Such labs can be accessed by students sitting from their home, and they could use this facility to conduct complex experiments that would also provide experiential learning to the students who cannot physically access the labs at BMU campus. Okay. Now, with the end of coronavirus pandemic, which is nowhere in sight, remote learning will continue to be the norm across all universities and colleges. So while classes have been shifted to majorly online mode of teaching in almost all the colleges and universities using video conferencing solutions, there are some aspects of education like practicals, laboratory exposure, and these conducted in different labs that still remain a challenge. Now, without these practicals, the knowledge of students, the expected knowledge will mainly remain theoretical, making it difficult for them to apply the knowledge learned in the classroom in real life situations at a later stage. There is also an even more serious issue when it comes to online classes conducted by technical colleges and universities, where students take admissions hoping that they be ready and employable in the world of technologies such as automation, artificial intelligence, robotics, data science, which in essence requires lots of hands-on practice with state-of-art machines and high-end software. So at BMU, we are pleased to inform you that during this crisis, we have seamlessly moved from physical classroom to online classes much before and at a time when others were waiting for the pandemic to get over a year back. So virtual labs are indeed a great way to practice your concepts in a much safer way and over internet. So our faculty have been kind of pioneer in using these virtual labs, for example, softwares for all purposes, virtual simulation environment that interact not only with the students but also with the machine elements. And this facility would this approach and this technology would help students to be better prepared to actually handle the actual labs when they come back to campus once the pandemic is over. So to discuss on this, we have with us some of our faculty from School of Engineering, BML Gunjal University, who will share their best experiences and best practices, and also give you all a glimpse of why and how they have adopted virtual labs into their respective courses. So I welcome all faculty, students, and parents alike to this interactive session. Let me first introduce the panel members. The first panelist for this event, I would invite Professor Babu to this discussion. So Professor Babu basically Professor Babu comes from the state of Andhra Pradesh and holds a PhD from NIT Kurukshetra. He is one of the founding faculty members of BMU, who started his journey way back in March 2014. Apart from his duties as a NSS program coordinator, Professor Babu is also actively involved in teaching as well as research. He currently teaches courses such as Physics for Engineers, Basic Electrical Engineering, Materials Characterization Techniques, and many more. He's also passionately involved in developing a solar energy lab at BML Gunjan University, where students will learn how to design residential solar power systems. I welcome Professor Babu to this discussion. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Maheshwar, and good evening to all panelists and dear students and parents. So I'm Dr. Sridhar Babu. I hope you can hear me. Can you hear me, please? Anyone of you, please confirm. Can you hear me? Am I audible? Yeah, that's great. That's great, Aryan. Yeah, nice. Okay. So, as Professor Maheshwar informed you, I teach physics for engineers to all BTEC students, along with other courses like material characterization techniques and also emerging material science and applications and basic electrical and electronics practice like that. Okay. So today I'm going to give you a glimpse of actually how we transformed our physical laboratory experience towards online experience. Okay. So let me present my screen. Yeah, I hope people can. So, can you see my screen? Is it clear and visible? Yeah, that's great. That's great. Yeah. So let us see. As part of the Physics for Engineers course, we don't have any laboratory component as such attached with the course, but as a practice, we take the students to the physics lab to gain experiential learning, okay? So that they go to the laboratory and then perform experiments which are related with the theory, whatever they are going through in their regular classes, okay? So I'm going to give you, information about one course, one experiment, especially because of the time constraint, okay? So the first experiment, what the students be doing in the physics lab, and they would be experiencing actually the laboratory experiment. That experiment is a Newton's ring experiment. It is the main aim of the student is to find wavelength of monochromatic light. Students go through the theory of this behind the experiment in theory classes, okay? And they go to the laboratory and they verify actually whether whatever they studied in the theory course, is it really there or not, okay? So this is the photograph, whatever you are seeing, they are the rings, concentric alternate dark and bright rings, which was, the photograph was taken by a student while performing his experiment in the physics lab, okay? So this is the, ring setup, whatever they can see in the physics lab physically, okay? So now let us see, this experiment is based on thin film interference. I believe some of you have a knowledge about the thin film interference. So thin film, if you consider we have a film, so whenever light incident on the film surface, okay, it will be reflected from the first surface, and then one will be transmitted into the thin film, and again it will be reflected back. Okay, so these two, the first one and the second one, and these two waves, they interfere. And we will see alternate dark and bright bands if you see this film actually in the reflector. But in Newton's ring experiment, we have an arrangement. Let us go through that arrangement. Okay, this is the experimental setup what we have in our physics lab as part of the Newton's ring experiment. Okay, here we have a plano convex lens and a plain glass plate. Every student can see these two things. Actually, every component of the experiment, they can hold in their hands and then they can fix them at the relevant positions, okay? So that they can see rings through the microscope, through this microscope. This is the experimental, schematic of the experimental facility. So here, this one is the planar convex lens, and this is the glass plate. So, and we have a monochromatic source, and this light actually coming from the monochromatic source is reflected towards this arrangement because of this glass plate, which is kept at 45 degrees. Okay, the reflected light from this portion, from this assembly will be observed by the microscope. Okay, we are using the microscope to observe the reflected light, okay, from this assembly. Okay, so if you see, then what you will be observing, that whatever actually you observed in the first slide, those are the rings. Okay, so these were first observed, and the experiment was performed by Newton. That's why the name Newton's ring experiment has been given. So this is the experimental setup, what we see, in physics lab. This is the, physical experimental setup available in the physics lab, okay? Students will be using this. So here, actually, this is the arrangement, actually, where we have kept a light source, and we have a convex lens here, and that the plano convex lens and the glass plate arrangement is kept here in this point. And this is the glass plate, which is kept at 45 degrees. And it is your microscope using which you can see the rings, okay? And so this is the scale, whatever the students will be using to take the measurements in physics lab, fine? Now, let us see actually how the students will be performing the same experiment virtually using virtual lab, okay? So this is what actually we used to do when the pandemic was not there, actually, prior to pandemic days. Okay, nowadays we are, because of the constraint, we are not in a position to use this. But however, actually, the lab is open to the students whenever they come, in whatever may be the year they are in. It may be second year or it may be third year. So they can come to the physics lab at any point of time and access these laboratory facilities. So this is the the link which will take you to the virtual experiment. Just I am going to use this one. So you need to click once on it. So please bear with me, it will take a few seconds. Yeah, this is it. So I hope you are seeing the same experimental setup, just you may not be in a position to distinguish whatever you saw in the physics lab, actually, and whatever you're seeing here in the virtual lab. The same experimental setup actually is, created or made available in the virtual lab also, okay? So, so this is the arrangement actually where, your plano convex lens and the glass plate assembly is there. And this is the microscope using which you will be seeing rings, okay? Newton's rings. And this is the scale, which is the magnified view, so that you can easily take the...
Hello, Dr. Babu. Yes. Yeah. Can I say that? I guess you have presented your PPT, so you may have to unshare and then do that. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor. Actually, I need to present this one.
No issue, sir. I was just wondering. I thought there is a problem at my end. Poor network, but students are also.
I need to present this one.
Sure.
Yeah. I was also wondering the same. If you could give a couple of from the
first beginning. I need to stop. I need to stop sharing, and I need to share the second screen. Okay. Oh, that's great. So I believe you are seeing actually the experimental setup. Can any one of you please?
Yeah, we can see it, sir.
Oh, that's great. So this is the experimental setup actually, which is created virtually, okay? It is available in the virtual lab, fine? So you people actually, when I was giving the presentation, so in the first slide, actually, you saw the same experimental setup in the physics lab also, okay? The same thing was there in the previous slides. So let me tell you what is the beauty of this virtual lab. So one thing is you can have the similar experience, whatever you are experiencing in the physics lab, you know, physically, the same physical, you know, same experience you can have in the virtual lab also. So other than that, the beauty is in the physics lab, you have limited constraints, like, you know, the limitation is you cannot change different light sources, okay, because of the time constraint also, okay. But in the virtual lab, you can use multiple light sources. And similarly, one more thing, in the physics lab, you may not be having multiple medium, but here in the virtual lab, you can vary the medium. Like if you see on the right-hand corner, so select medium, there is one option, which is select medium. If you click on the, you know, on this button, you will be seeing, so different media, air, water, acetone, isopropyl alcohol, kerosene. So you can actually perform the experiment with different media between your, you know, plano convex lens and the plain glass plate. So this is one beauty. You can do, you know, multiple experiments and you can verify. Okay. And the second one, light source, okay, which is very much required. And you are going to find the wavelength of that light source only. Of course, not only to find the wavelength of a light source, okay, so you are going to find many other things actually using this experiment. It has many real industrial applications. So here you can have different sources of lights: sodium, neon, green light, and red light. Okay, so you can use you know, four different colored lights. Okay, so you can perform actually you know, those experiment with all those colored lights. And then you can do a small research also on this. Okay. Now, when I switch on the light, so we need to first select the medium, that is acetone is selected. And next, I need to select the source, sodium. Now I need to just click on light on. Yeah. Now light is on. So you see the, you know, the rings, what you are going to see using the microscope. The similar kind of ring pattern was also displayed to you in the presentation. Okay, that photograph was taken from the physics lab only by a student when he was performing the experiment. Okay, one more variation what you can do here in the virtual lab is, so the radius of the lens. So this radius of the lens, you will be using only one radius of curvature for the plano convex lens in our physics lab. Okay. So, but here you can have multiple radius of curvature. See, I'm changing the radius of curvature and you can see what kind of variation you are observing in the ring pattern. So now it is 55 centimeter. I change it further. It is 60 centimeter. So you can clearly observe there is a, you know, the ring pattern, actually the diameter of the ring is depending on the radius of curvature of the lens also. Okay. So you can observe it clearly. So you can, do variation in the radius of curvature of the lens also. Okay, so by using you know, this virtual lab, you can have multiple variations while performing the experiment, which could not be possible in physics lab, in physical physics labs, because of the time constraints and students has to go through you know, the things as per the time table, actually whatever they receive, fine. But here, this virtual lab, they can do at any point of time by sitting in their home, okay? And what they will be doing in physics lab, you know, in physical lab as well as in virtual lab, they will be finding the diameter of the rings, okay? So there is a connection between the diameter of the ring and the wavelength of the monochromatic light. So once they calculate the diameter of the rings, they can find out the wavelength of the monochromatic light. So that's about this Newton's ring experiment. Okay. Next, I would like to present one more experiment. Professor Maheshwar, do I have a little more time? Professor Maheshwar, do I have a little more time so that I can...
Maheshwar, sir,
you are in mute.
Yeah. I'm still on mute.
Okay.
I guess so. Professor Babu, you continue, then I think he'll intervene.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Let me share my screen again. Let me take you to the another experiment, actually, what students, you know. This is, can you see my screen?
This is
how actually we people give students the assignment. Okay, so each and every student will be getting a different specifications. The first students will be finding the wavelength of the monochromatic light with radius of the lens as 90 centimeters, and he will be measuring the diameter of the rings whose number is 5, 10, 15. What about the second student? Second student's radius of lens is 80 centimeters, and the ring numbers are 2, 4, 6, 8. So what we can do is we can have multiple combinations so that no two students will be having the same set of measurements, but the end result will be same because there is a dependency. Okay, the diameter and the radius of curvature, all those dependencies there. But when you calculate the wavelength, you will be getting the single answer. Okay, which is the standard answer. Now, the second experimental setup, actually, what the students even I love to do this one. So let me, so I need to stop sharing. I need to go back to the another screen. Okay. Yes. Okay. So this is, the experiment. Can anyone of you please confirm? Can you see my screen where
it is visible, sir.
Constant is written?
Dr. Babu, it is visible.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. Okay, this is one more experiment where the students will be connecting with wires the required apparatus, and then they will be performing the experiment to find out the Planck's constant. So see how you can connect very simply just you put your cursor and then try to pull out. Okay, the wire automatically comes out, and it will also give you the direction where it is to be connected. Just place it there. It is connected. Okay, like this, So, of course, other than this, actually, you need to be cautious also, because there is a circuit diagram. You need to follow the circuit diagram, okay, while connecting. But to make your life simple, okay, here, we are getting that arrow signs so that it can be, your life will become more simple. Okay. Yeah. See, now I connected. And you can verify the circuit diagram also. These connections are as per the circuit diagram. Once the connections are ready, then only the insert key option on the right hand side. Okay, on the right hand side, there is a tab that is variables. Under the variables, we have one option where you can choose the LED. So there are multiple LEDs, red color LED, green LED, and yellow color LED, blue and infrared. Okay. So these LEDs are there, you can choose any one. And now if you put key, so when you insert key, then only the circuit will be closed. Then actually your this rheostat value, it will show, it will be active. Okay, now if you go on changing the rheostat value, the potential across the diode will be varying. So that potential across the diode is measured by the voltmeter, which is given here. So the same experimental setup is available in the physics lab also. The same as it is, actually, you can see. Okay, in the physics lab, the same is available in the virtual lab also, so that you can have the similar feeling. Okay, but the second thing is you can have multiple options actually in the virtual lab. Fine. Now, if you go on changing the rheostat value, the voltage across the diode will be changed. How can you change it? By using your right and left hand arrow key on the keyboard. Okay, just I am changing. You can see the voltage is varying, but current is zero. At a specific value of voltage, the charge carriers will attain sufficient kinetic energy, okay, and they will recombine. When they recombine, then there will be emission of the light, okay, light photon, okay, using the, you know, the energy required actually to overcome the energy barrier, okay, so that we are supplying using the potential, okay, external potential. It is the forward bias LED, okay. So once we give sufficient voltage, then the electron will attain sufficient energy, that is E multiplied by V. Okay, so once it attains that energy, then it will jump actually from the barrier and it will recombine with the holes. So then there will be emission of the light photon. Okay, fine. So you can observe actually when that barrier jumping is happening, then only you will start observing the current flowing in the circuit. So that is the position where you can say, yeah, now the potential whatever we applied is, you know, equal to or greater than the barrier potential. So you can observe directly, just I am doing it, so that please be keep your eyes on the current ammeter, okay. Yes, so you observed that thing, okay. Till 1.903 volts. So there is no current in the circuit. That means the charge carriers did not gain sufficient energy so that they can cross the potential barrier, okay? Now see, at 1.908 volts. So now the current started flowing in the circuit. That means the barrier potential has crossed, okay? So by knowing this voltage value, you can start actually using the equations and you can find out Planck's constant, okay? So here what you can do is you can change multiple colored LEDs, because see, different colored LEDs means different potential barriers. So if there are different potential barriers, then we need to give different potentials to the LED. So those values of the potential is also called as knee voltage, at which the potential barrier is overtaken by the applied potential energy. Okay, so this is the second experiment what students also enjoyed. Actually, not only this, along with them, students also perform some experiments related to polarization and also related to diffraction. Okay, so that's it from my side. I believe you understood. Shall I stop sharing screen? I hope I stopped.
Yeah. So, thank you, Professor Babu, for sharing your expertise. And also, personally, I really like the way you dealt with, difficult physical problems through the use of virtual labs. Thank you once again. And our next panelist that I would like to invite is Dr. Kiran Khattar. Professor Kiran Khattar has over 15 years of experience in academics and industry. She completed M.Tech from Punjabi University, Patiala, and PhD from Himachal Pradesh University, Shimla. Her research interests span analysis of software quality using fuzzy modeling, neurotrophic sets, image processing, and nature-inspired algorithms. She is a technology enthusiast and passionate about programming. She was a corporate trainer for Java-enabled technologies, web services, and web scripting languages. She also conducts placement and technical training sessions with focus on to develop problem-solving skills and abilities that support professional studies and prepare the students for professional work. Thank you, Professor Kiran, for joining here. So Dr. Kiran, can you please give us a brief about the virtual labs that you have used in your classroom?
Yeah,
and how sure. Teaching software programming or software development through the online mode has remained a challenge, whether it's remained a challenge for you, or how do you actually comprehend this problem?
Right. Thank you, Dr. Dwivedi. And I have planned my presentation. I hope all the queries would be answered. How faculty members at BMU deal with computer science courses where the programming, teaching programming online is a little bit tough, but still we try with the help of animation and virtual labs. So that's what I'm going to present it over here. Can you please confirm, is my screen visible?
Yes, it's visible. Yes.
Okay. So let's begin. What I have planned for today, there are multiple ways to do that. Firstly, I'll go with the basic one. How do we teach students the basic fundamental logic, how loop works? Then I'll give in a demo on application of a loop through virtual. Then I'll tell you further application, deep application on data structure, how sorting works, how do we teach them. And if time permits, then I'll give you a glimpse of website demo as well as blockchain demo as well. So let's go ahead with that. Now suppose I have to teach to first year student how to program, how can we count, number of persons sitting in a one room, right? So they could be a one person, they could be two person, three, or could be an N number of persons. Suppose you are given a task and there is a one room, there are a group of people and you are given a task. You have to write a program how to count, give me a count of those persons who are there. So how will you do that? So for this, a kind of animation which I prepared it, I took in a one variable, which is initialized as a zero, n equal to zero. Then I'll keep on counting each and every person in a room. And then I'll keep on incrementing n is equal to n plus one. So that would be the very easy solution, which we could do that. But is it, the efficient solution? That also we need to look at it. Being a computer science student or being a computer engineer, you do not have to look at the possible solution, but you have to look at what could be the optimum solution as well. And how can you make it more optimized? How can you make it more efficient? Now, there is an example. I have created in a one room and there are four people in this room. And let's start counting these number of people with the help of a program. So initial value of n is zero. So here, initial value of n is zero. When I counted this person, I incremented n as a one, zero plus one. Now I'm going to count another one. So initial value of n in my hand is now one. And when I'll increment, this n will become two. Now again, I am counting it. Again, it is n is equal to 2, and now it is becoming 3. Again, I am counting next person, n is equal to 3, already my previous value, then I am going to add it, and this is how the loop comes. You are writing only in a one statement, and it is going, being iterated multiple number of times, right? Now, let's see that counting one person at a time where there is a room, and you have a, large crowd over there, you have a, more number of people, then it would be more time consuming. Can we make it more efficient? Can we refine it? Yeah, we can refine it. Why do I count only in a one person at a time? Can't I count, two people at a time? So that could be there. So let's understand, again, there is a room, which is group of four people, and I'm counting two people so at a time. So initially I was doing n is equal to n plus one. Now I'm gonna do that n is equal to n plus two. So for each pair of people, right, person, I'm going to do that increment by two. So initial value of n is zero. So you could see that initial value of n is zero. And when I did that zero plus two, I got two. Now my current value of n is two. And when am I doing that? So it is becoming now four, right? So now, but the problem in this algorithm as well, what's the problem we have? Right, though I keep on moving that, what if there are odd number of people? If I am counting two people at a time, so can we make it more refinement to that algorithm? Yes, we can have it. Now let's take a example where I have a loop and I have a condition also. How are we going to do that? For each pair in room, what am I going to do that? I'll always make by two. When I am left with only one person at the last, I will do n is equal to n plus one. Now you could see that I have created a room. Just imagine this is a room and there are how many number of people we have? 5. So initial value of n is 0. We do have, 0 in our hand, and we are counting two people at a time. So n is becoming 2. Again, I'm going with the second iteration. Now, again, I'll add 4, but now I am left with only one person. So this is the reason my conditional execution is happening within a program. If there is a one person in the room, then you have to increment by only one. So that could be the easiest way with the help of a presentation we teach theory. Right. Now, this is all, suppose I am teaching in a class and I told them how do the loop works. Now, the student would come up within a question that, okay, this is the loop, but give us some kind of a practical application. Where do we use that? Right. So let me unshare and let's move to the application now. So I'll go with this. I think here there is a problem over here because it does not allow me to do that. Can you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am, we can see.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess so, because I had to unshare because it does not allow me to move to the next step. Right. So let's move to now application of a loop. So this is the virtual lab where I'm going to calculate over here factorial of 5. Suppose here I'm going to do that, calculate factorial 5 with the help of a program. So P is the number where you have to calculate the factorial. So I'm going to start. So what value I have given over here, P is a 5. And we know that whenever we have to calculate of a number, so you have to, multiply that number by decrementing it by 1, 5 is to 4, 4 is to 3. And then you keep on doing that. And at the end, you will have your, factorial in your hand. So this is the program. Suppose we have written now, we have taken on a one variable in our hand, and the P is that variable where it stores the number, and I would like to calculate the factorial of that number. So here P value I have given as a 5, and I would like to calculate the factorial of that 5. Now if P is equal to 0, now when I'll decrement 5 is to 4 is to 3 is to 2 and then 1 and then 0, then I have to stop my program. So if P is equal to 0, I am going to return. It means that I am trying to exit from my program, and here I say that int I is equal to 5, and till the time you have keep on doing this particular statement, repeat it again and again, where I value is greater than equal to 1. So it means I am going to start with the value of I as a 5. I'll decrement 4, 3, 2, 1, and when it is 0, then I'll come out of that program. And every time I am going to multiply I value with the fact variable, and the fact value initially is 1. Let's see that it might be, going beyond understanding, because this is your first. I'm sure that few of might not, have gone through this coding classes during the school. And let's understand with the help of the simulation. So what exactly it is. Okay, so now when I'll keep on doing it over here, initially I is equal to what? 5. And here 1 star 5 is equal to 5. So fact value is 1, 1 is multiplied by 5. Now you have to decrement I as a 4. Now when I'll click on next here, again my loop is going, and you could see that I value is becoming now 4. My initial value of fact was 1, but in the first iteration it became 5. So 5 is multiplied by 4, and then it became 20. And when keep on doing that, 20 multiplied by 3 will give you 60, and 60 multiplied by 2 will give you over here 120. And then I value is equal to 1, it will not contribute to anything, right? You could save your iteration over here also. So code running is over. So initially understand how the loop works, and then you understand that what is the application of that loop, right? Now, this is a very easy example of factorial, and when we move gradually and towards coding, then we go to an more data structure algorithm. And suppose I'm giving you some random numbers and I say that sort these numbers in terms of arranging, right? Arrange it in ascending order. So that you will say that it is very easy. You just give me a number and I know that which number is greater than which one and which is smaller and I'll arrange it. Okay, so you can do it in your mind, you can do it on your paper, but when it comes to doing it in a program, how are you going to do that, right? So there are a various way to do that sorting until we do not know about data structure. We knew only in a one type of a sorting. I compare these two numbers. If the one is smaller, I'll keep it at a first. And if it is a larger, I'll keep it in moving, you know, backwards. So what are different kinds of a sorting? That also is an example of loop. I'm going to demonstrate that part also. Just allow me to share that screen, right? And the screen which I'm going to present it right now and the kind of a simulation, and this is created by second year students. So I'm very proud that one of my students, he helped me, you know, by giving us this kind of, you know, a visual demonstration where during this pandemic time, we can say that one also. Right. Okay. So these are a few numbers which you could see that I think there is a problem. Yeah. These are few numbers and these are random numbers. And you could see here it is a bubble sort. This is selection sort. And this is what? Insertion sort. How bubble sort works? It says that it will compare first two numbers, right? And it will bring, you know, the smaller number at the first and the larger number, it will push it backwards. Again, it will compare next two numbers. So let's start with it. And I just make the speed as a slow. And you could do that over here. Yeah, I'm gonna start it here. So 28 and 10, 52, again coming forward, right? Again, there is a swapping, right? Again, two numbers are being compared. So every time it is comparing these two numbers and which one is smaller, taken forward, which one is larger, taken backward, right? And now you could see that over here, I have moved largest number. I have sorted one number by comparing this thing that is 310 and which is moved at last. Again, I started with remaining numbers, comparing two values at a time, and I'm moving the smaller value first. And now I got 296 as the largest number. So this is a kind of a bubble sort where student can understand that this sorting will work when you compare two values at a time, right? And by this kind of a method, you are sorting only one number at a time and you are sorting highest number. Earlier you sorted this 310, then you are sorting next highest, and then you are bringing or arranging this 286 value and bringing it to its desired position or appropriate position where it deserves to be there as per sorting. So this is known as bubble sorting, right? Now let's move to now selection sort. Okay, so I am going to now refresh, right? And let's understand how this selection sort works. Okay, so let me just do the speed as a slow. Now how this selection sort works, right? Let's understand through this demo over here. Right, I'm going to do that. In this selection sort, it is examining each and every list. It is going to each and every number, right? And finding out which is the smaller number. Smaller number 22, so it's selected. Now the remaining number, it is going to do that. And it found 36 as a smaller number, so it brought it over there. Now it found again 38 as a smaller number, it is moved. So what bubble sort says that? That compare two numbers at a time. But selection sort say that go through all the numbers and find out the first smallest. Then go through all remaining numbers, find out the second smallest. And similarly, you keep on examining the remaining numbers, right? And finding out which one is the smallest. And at the end, you will have all the data in, you know, sorted ascending order, because this sorting, I'm telling it to you, this particular, you know, kind of simulation is being done only for, you know, arranging the numbers in ascending order, right? So we understood now bubble sort and we understood now in selection sort as well. Now let's move in another application. Now suppose I am teaching a student how insertion sort works. Right, so I'm going to do that over here, right? Okay, so speed is now slow so that you can understand this kind of color changing and how this swapping is being done. Now, in case of an insertion sort, it is taking first two numbers at a time, then it brought 210, then it is taking three numbers at a time and then sorting first three number, then it is taking first four numbers and arranging all, then again it is selecting five numbers, then it will keep on selecting six numbers. Now you could see that, right? Now, okay, so 210, it's arranging all numbers. So what it does then, it takes two number in a hand, it does sorting of these two numbers, then it takes first three numbers, then it does sorting of first three, then it takes first four numbers. So that's how it insertion sort says that we will keep on what it says that we will keep on examining the list of the numbers by adding one and one, one number next into the existing list where we would like to compare, and we'll keep on, sorting this small list of numbers and keep on increasing this list by adding one new number which we supposed to sort it. So that's how we teach that how bubble sort, selection sort and insertion sort works, right? Okay, so I hope I'm not expecting that whatever I'm telling it that you are understanding it also, but you can understand that how we faculty member are trying to explain each and everything, though in this pandemic time this is not on a physical class, I cannot go to anyone's bench and can make that correct. This how works. So this is the way we try to make various means to make everybody understand that how this programming works and what is the meaning of each and every programming fundamental block, right? Okay. So, Dr. Dwivedi, can I move to next? Do we have time?
Yes, we have time. Please go ahead.
Okay. Right. Now, I move to now another one. And Dr. Dwivedi, again, I'll have to take a confirmation. I'm going to play a video over here, right? So that video does not have voice. You have to just confirm it is visible or not.
Sure. Please, yeah.
Okay. So is that visible?
Screen is visible, but the application
video is not.
Video is
okay. So I guess there is a problem here. Okay, let me just do that then.
You could share once again, we'll come out of it. Sure.
Can I see? I can
see.
Yeah,
I can see. Yeah, it's visible. Right.
Okay.
Something is being written. Yeah.
Yeah, something is being written. So this is one of the recording of my lecture. Sometimes, we do understand the student face internet connectivity issue as well. So we try to make the recording. So this is one of my recording of lectures where I am telling the students, how to do web programming. So when I do coding and web programming is what? You do something and you see it on the website. So how will it work? So I have already marked over here. So I'm going to now 4 minutes, right? I'm going to take it up over here where I'm teaching student how to create a box, right? Okay, so simultaneously I am coding for it and this is my browser. People can understand that what is the effect of each and every coding over here. So I am creating a box which is of this dimension, width is of 200 pixel and height is also of 200 pixel, right? Now I say that I want a box of 200 by 200 dimension and I want in this box hello to be written, but nothing is visible. My box is not visible because I have not given the background color to my box. So the moment I'll write over here background color as a green, okay, aquamarine, I have taken it. So you could see there is a box. Now I would like my box to move towards right in the center. I gave the margin and it is coming up over here. So here you could see that the moment I'm writing the coding, I am demonstrating right away. The student could see both these screens simultaneously so they can understand the effect of this coding, what I am writing and what is the effect of that one. Okay, now let me go to another timestamp which I have recorded over here, that's 10. So let's move to back one and I'm gonna now take you to 10. Yeah, here I'm telling that if you have created a box, right? And suppose you would like to take an action, and what that action, when you click on a box, then what message it should come? When you click on a text, what message it should come? So you could see that when I'm clicking on a box, it says that I'm a division. When I'm clicking on a text, now let me play it again, right? You could see it over here. Right. The moment I clicked on a box, it says I am a revision. And moment I am going to click on hello, it is showing over here, I'm a, you know, a header, right? So that's how we make that student to understand that how to make this click event happen. We every day, we, I think I need not to say that or explain that what is click event. We all are in internet era world. I know that when I click on save, what happens? When I click on camera, then what happens? It means that you are giving a command. You are saying that when I click this, this particular action need to be performed, right? Now, let me go to another timestamp, which is what? Yeah, 2048. So I'm going to take it up over there. Okay, so here I am telling students, right? I created two buttons over here and I say that let's say repeatedly and stop saying hello repeatedly. And you could see it over here. Here it is 1000 millisecond I have given time. So every time it is giving me a hello after every second, but I'm not getting the time to now stop my, you know, stop saying hello. I have two buttons, one to keep saying hello, and another button where I say that now enough, you have said so many hellos, now stop saying that. But I have given very less time, so it is not allowing me to do that. So what am I doing it over here? You could see it. I say that now you say hello every 3 seconds, right? So it is saying now every 3 seconds me hello, so that I could buy the time. If I have to stop, I can go and I stop it over here. So now you'll see that after a few seconds, I'll go and I'll click on stop saying hello, and then, you know, it will stop. So this kind of interaction also, you know, we try to do the coding and we try to demonstrate that well. Now you could see that I am writing over here a one function. When somebody clicks on stop saying hello, then I would like to clear my timer, right? I do not want to run it into a loop again and again saying hello to me, right? So just bear with me a few more seconds, I guess, and then it would be shown over here, right? Yeah, so it is, right? Again, hello, yeah, it is. Okay, so yeah, it is hello. Now I'll just go over there and go to stop, right? So then it would be stopped over there. Yeah, so see that here I clicked. Now you will not see any kind of a loop, you know, another hello message, right? Now let me take you to another timestamp, right, which is 3530. So I'm taking to that one, right? Because this is just a glimpse of how are we teaching, but anyway, in the class, we do coding and simultaneously we do that. Now, all of you might have installed any kind of a software, and when you run setup, you always see the progress bar, right? So I have done what over here? Created a kind of a progress bar. The moment we click on, let's check the progress. The way you see that your software is getting downloaded, and you'll see the progress over here. Can you see that? Yes, this kind of an interaction is being happening, right? So that's how we try to, you know, arrange the code, and simultaneously we try to present that what is the effect of that code, right? So let me stop it, right? Okay, so Dr. Dwivedi is smiling. Yeah. Okay, right. Now, let me take you to another one as well. Right. Okay, and before it starts, and I go to now Zoom and present my screen again.
Dr. Kiran?
Yeah.
There is a message from student. Mm-hmm. If you would like to address that, or I think any of us can, but
Sure. I'll do that. Just this after this video, when I'll unshare, I'll come back and I'll do that. Is that right?
Sure. Yeah, please. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So I'm going to take it up over there to in a certain timestamp where I am teaching students how to develop Android app, right? Every day we have our Android mobile, we see a lot of apps to place an order for food, to buy, you know, any item, maybe our Myntra, maybe Amazon, how these apps get developed. So that's what I'm teaching it. And one of the major feature of app, which we always generally use whenever we travel, we always try to find out our location coordinates, right? So where I am teaching the students how this Google Map works, right? So I'm taking it up over there. You could see it over here. Here I'm presenting my mobile, right? So this is my mobile and I'm telling that if I'm opening my mobile, this is my app and you can click picture. Now I have created in one app, which is as a map, right? And when I had this recording, I was in Gurgaon. So it is showing my location as a, Haryana, right? So when it will do that, keep on zooming and then I want that it to display some message also. Say, this is my current location. So, and it will show this is my new location coordinates. So that also kind of a demo, we do that, how to use that Google Map. And if you would like to write maybe your latitude and longitude, that coordinates you would like to write, you would like to, display country name, you would like to display any other thing. So how to code that part. So that is also in a demo of mobile application development, right? Now, let me get back to you over here. Yeah.
Okay, so these are, I think, general comments which the student have asked.
Okay,
take this up at the end of the session also.
Right? Very right. There is a one question that there could be scenario where student gets stuck with an issue and teacher intervention is needed. If it is in the class and you guys are doing it, what I'll do that, I'll ask you to present your screen, right? And I'll see your code and then I'll help, right? I help the students. Or if it is after the class, we give extra hours also, student may mail it, student may, get that meeting time, we can fix up the meeting, you present your screen and we'll, help in doing that. Yeah, that is true. Had it been in a physical class, we would have gone to that particular bench and solved there and then only. But here also, if it is in the class, you are just a click away. Right? You have to click so that I can be on your desk and I can check your code. So you have to just say that, unmute, ma'am, I'm facing a problem. I'll say that, okay, you share your screen and then I'll help you. So I guess I have answered your question. Yeah. Okay, great. Okay, ma'am, any idea about class starting for upcoming batch? Though I have an idea, but we do have, Abhinandan with us. Abhinandan, could you please tell that, address this question?
Sure, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. And to answer that question, I would like to tell that, we are hoping to start the classes somewhere towards the starting of the month of September or the end of August, but we are yet to release the actual dates for that, and we're still waiting for guidelines from UGC and all of, because we were hoping to start physical classes on the university's campus, because we are really keen to now have candidates and all of the students on the university campus. So yes, the tentative timeline is somewhere towards the end of August or starting of September.
Okay. Dr. Dwivedi, am I done with my session?
So, yes. So, thank you, Professor Kiran Khattar. You have provided the students an alternative platform for teaching key concepts in computer science. I remember during my days, three decades ago, how challenging it was in visualizing abstract concepts in computer science. And now, even more so in the online mode. So, thank you for sharing your experiences, Professor.
Maheshwar, sir, no. There is another question in the chat box.
No, we can take it up in the next, at the end of the session.
At the end, thanks. Yes.
Yeah. So moving on, our next panelist is Dr. Rajiv Day. Dr. Rajiv Day has completed his PhD from Indian Institute of Information Technology, Design and Manufacturing, Jabalpur. He joined BMU in the year 2018 and is actively engaged in teaching and research. He has taught subjects such as embedded system, IoT, and control systems. He has about 10 years of teaching experience in various organizations, including National Institutes of Technology and IIIT. So, Professor De, I understand that students taking admissions into electronics and mechanical engineering would have this, you know, leading question that it has always been the opinion amongst the students that online classes, you know, may not be suited for mechanical and electronic students, right? So the direct experience of working with machines and instruments is, by the way, most critical to student learning. So I hope you will you would give us more, you know. So can you just take us through some of your innovations that you have done to address this challenge in your course?
So good evening, everyone. I'll show you all some software tools and online tools that I basically use while teaching microprocessors, embedded system, IoTs, all that, right? So first I'll tell about the microprocessor. So let me share my screen. So suppose I want to teach microprocessor. So you can see in this protein simulator, right? So in this simulator, what we can do, we can design various types of circuits using a microprocessor, or you can say microcontroller, right? Different types of circuits can be made. And on the real time basis, you can visualize the output or run the circuit also, right? For example, here you can see that. Just a minute. Let me zoom it. So here you can see that this is the 8086 microprocessor chip, right? So suppose you want to teach about what is 8086 microprocessor chip and how they are basically interface with different other electronic devices or chips. So we can take the help of this software to this is from here we have to pay. And in this keypad, we have to write the code in the form of addresses. Right. Because in a microprocessor, when we want to program it, so we basically program it using a language known as assembly language, right? So assembly language is all about writing code in the form of mnemonics, and each mnemonic is represented by addresses, right? So here we have to write some addresses, right? So suppose we want to teach more in depth about the assembly language. So what we can do in case of just a minute. So in place of using this tool, we can use different other tool. For example, this is another simulator of that same microprocessor, in which we can teach the students about writing the assembly code, right? So in this is all about the assembly code is written. This is a simple assembly code which will print in the screen, hello world. You can see it here that the hello world will be printed hello world like this, right? So here you after writing the code, you need to compile it. You can compile it by pressing this emulate, right? And you can run it. If you run it, it will show you the output. So you can see here that it is printed, right? So in the same way, in our laboratories also, there are hardware kits. If you run the same program on those hardware kits, the same result will come out, right? So in this way, using these tools, we are basically teaching microprocessor in an online mode, right? So just a minute. Now, if I talk about embedded system, for example, I'll tell you just a minute. In the embedded system, we teach different types of microcontroller based circuits, right? So for that also, is it visible, this software?
No, right. I can't see.
Just a minute. Just a minute. So So here you can see that we for teaching microcontroller or embedded system based circuits, right? We use this tool. This is again Proteus simulator. So here I'll show you some sample design that we teach in our class, right? So suppose if you are going to teach some stepper motor controller, you have seen stepper motors in printers, right? Printers and the scanning machines, all these contain stepper motors. Stepper motors are also connected in robotic arms, right? And there are different devices that are readily used in the industry which use a stepper motor. So here you can see that this figure shows a stepper motor. This is a stepper motor, and this is basically a microcontroller 8890C5, and this is the motor driver, right? So in our class we will teach that what are microcontroller, how they are interfaced with the motor driver, how to design the entire circuitry, and after designing the circuitry in this software, right, we can run it also, right? For example, you can see that if I press this button, it is rotating anti-clockwise. If I press this button, so it is rotating anti-clockwise. In this way, there are various types of designs that we teach using this software tool. For example, here you can see that if we are talking about a calculator, right? So we can show students that how calculator is made. So this is the microcontroller chip, and all these are the peripheral chips that are needed to be connected with this microcontroller, and there is some coding needed. So coding for doing code of these microcontrollers are used. So that I am not showing you, right? So for example, if you want to see the demo of this calculator, you can just press this play button and you can see that 5 multiplied by 6, what is the value? It will show you 30, right? So in this way, we can teach how digital electronic circuits can be interfaced with a microcontroller and how you create different applications using this, right? So for this, no lab is required. Why? Everything is in the software only. So these things are software tools, but there are some online tools also. For example, if you visit
Dr. Ranjit,
sorry. Yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
Not visible.
Yes, sir. Yeah, if you could wind up quickly so that we, I think some.
Yeah, please.
Thank you.
Yeah. For example, if you visit this tinkercad.com, and if you want to see LCD concept, that how to interface an LCD with an Arduino, right? So we can design that circuit here. If it starts simulation, you can see the displays coming in this LCD, right? So there are multiple number of tools that we are using to teach the students online, in an online mode. So that's all from my side. So over to Dr.
Yeah. So thank you, Dr. Rajiv De, for the wonderful presentation of how technology can complement teaching and improve the visualization process. So much so that students need not miss the physical presence experience. Of course, I'm taking it too far away, but now I'll invite my next speaker, Dr. Anubhav Agarwal. Dr. Anubhav is from Uttarakhand. He's earned his PhD from IIT Roorkee in 2017 and is actively engaged in teaching and research. Joined BMU in the year 2017 as an assistant professor in School of Engineering and Technology. In his current assignment, he teaches basic electrical engineering, which is a foundation course that is offered to all the first year students. So now I invite Dr. Anubhav to discuss in brief the kind of experiences that he's giving his students in this class, please.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Devedi. Good evening, students, and to the parents also. This is Dr. Anubhav, and I teach courses from first year to the final year students of electronics and communication and electronics and computer engineering course. Here, I would like to share you how we were handling the experiments probably, or we can say the hands-on session during the conditions for the basic electrical engineering lab. Since this particular course is a hardware course where the students are making the circuits in the lab and they are performing the experiments. So in this scenario, when the students were not able to visit the lab, it was slightly challenging in the sense because when you connect the theory with the laboratory experience, the grip or the content becomes good. But that was challenging at the start. Before actually formally starting the virtual lab concept, I would like to share one thing with you. And I think all of you would agree with me that with all of the courses or any time whenever you have gone to any of the laboratories, the first thing your lab assistant or your supervisor or your teacher would have told you, be very careful, don't touch the things, right? I think all of you would agree. Many people say don't touch things. The second thing is that whenever you are doing the experiments in the laboratory, the experiments are very fixed. Fixed, I mean to say that you are being provided a manual. And as whatever is written step by step in the manual, the same values of whatever the components you need to take, you will take. So if let's say a circuit is being made and you need to take 20 ohm or 50 ohm as the resistance, you are not going to think that let's take a resistance of 100 ohm. Probably there could be a shortage of the resistance, or maybe you won't try it, right? I mean, this is just a very simple human tendency. So what this concept of virtual labs brings is that it helps you to actually encounter or whatever these things were happening, it is going to give you another form of enjoyment where you can build your own circuits. You can take any values you want. And by the way, be very careful when I'm talking about the electrical engineering lab, there will be voltage and current in the circuit. So it is not like a lab of computer science where you would be doing coding on the software. Here you need to be careful with the current and the voltage which is present in the circuit. So this particular challenge also gets away when we are doing the experiments in the virtual lab, because there is no fear of getting any shock. There is no fear of any short circuit in the circuit. So the students, sometimes I feel that they tend to do something extra. They tend to do many different combinations, and that is where the learning curve becomes better and high. So I would like to share the presentation. Is the presentation visible?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, yeah, thank you. So I won't go long with the presentation, just very, very basic. So these are various different virtual labs platforms which are available on the internet. And anybody of you right now, anybody of you can go through these web links and you can start doing anything, whatever is coming in your mind, right? Just all whatever the basic theory is required, that is also available. And whatever the steps are to be done, they are also written very, very clearly. So these two things helps us to understand the concept or the theory behind whatever the experiment we are doing. So here today in this session, I would like to touch up a couple of experiments here. So one experiment, one theorem we tend to study is the theorem of the superposition. Now superposition theorem says that whenever, let's say, there is a circuit and in this particular circuit, there are two voltage sources which are present, a 75 voltage source and a 64 voltage source. So these are two DC batteries which are present in your circuit. And there are various resistances which are available. Now, as per your knowledge, which you have done in the physics course in your 12th examination, you can quickly solve it using the Kirchhoff's current law, voltage law, and you can do those mesh analysis very, very easily, right? So I'm not going into that you can't do it. What I am trying to tell is that this theorem helps you, and it says that whenever such is a scenario, when there are two or more than two sources present in the circuit, then in order to find out what would be the current which would be flowing in these resistances because of these two voltage sources present, then what we do, we consider one voltage source at a time and we tend to neglect the other sources which are present. And then we are going to find out or calculate the current which is flowing in our resistances. We are going to repeat this step for all other sources which are present in the circuit. And finally, we will be superimposing the result. Now, the moment when I say superimpose, because current is something which has direction also. Like if the current is flowing from left to right or right to left, then there will be plus and minus signs which will be coming up in the picture. So superimposing means that we will add if the currents were flowing in the same direction, or we will subtract if they are in the different direction. That is very, very obvious. So it means that in this scenario, in this particular question, what we did as the first step, we removed the 75 voltage source and we did the short circuitry. This is something different. Why we do short or why we do open, that is not here to be discussed. So now in this particular circuitry, this is a very simple circuit where 5 and 20 are in parallel, then the combination is in series, then the combination is in parallel, and then it is in series. So you can very quickly solve this particular resistive network and find out how much would be the current which will be flowing. And then using the KCL law, you can find out the individual currents which are flowing in this resistance. Similarly, you can find out the resistances currents in the other branches also by considering the 75 voltage source. Now, what by this particular experiment, we were able to do this in the theory. We were able to solve the problems in the class using the Google Meet platform. We were able to make students do the problems either in the assignments or during the quizzes or in the interaction whenever we are doing. But again, the challenge comes that if I was in a position to take my students to my lab and then do this experiment, it would have been very fun for them. But since it was not possible, what we were able to do is, I'm just sharing the screen again. So what we were able to do was this. Students, are you able to see the screen?
Yeah,
thank you. So what we were able to do here was that, just a minute. Yeah. So this is a scenario where we said that this virtual lab platform, which we took from the web, here is a scenario where there are two voltage sources present to us, voltage source V1 and voltage source V2. And there are resistances which are connected in the circuit. So there are three resistances right now which are connected. Now, all these five variables, V1, V2, and R1, R2, R3, all these five variables are in your hand. Whatever combination you want to try, you try, right? So right now, any student wants to try, he can try. And then by trying the different combinations, he would be in a position to understand the concept of superposition in certainly a better manner. So here, for example, the superposition theorem said that first let us connect both the voltage sources in the circuit and find out how much is the current which are flowing in these emitters, right? So I am going to case number one, and I am doing both of them connected to the power, and randomly I am giving some values, right? When randomly I gave some values, it simulated and it gave me some values in ampere for the currents which are flowing in resistance R1, R2 and R3, right? Likewise, so I can change these values and I can find the result. Now for these values, what is the next step? It says that go to case two, and for the voltage V2, go to the short circuit. Now what we are doing, we are disconnecting the voltage V2 here. Only voltage V1 is connected, and because of this voltage V1, how much is the current which is flowing in these branches, we can identify. So we will simulate and we will get some results, right? Similarly, for case 3, I will do the short circuit for voltage V1 and power circuit to voltage V2, and then again I would simulate. Now these are the data which I have got for my condition. Now I am filling the data. Look, So this is one step which I did some time ago. Now here you can see very clearly that these values are the results when both the voltage V1 and V2 are present, right? Now see here, only for one branch, let us see. In this scenario, when both were connected, for the resistance R1, the current was 0.25 amperes, right? Let us verify. Is it getting verified? Let's see. For when only V1 was present, the current which was flowing was 0.5 amperes. And only when V2 was present, the current was flowing as minus 0.25 amperes. Again, why this minus sign is coming? Because whenever power is connected here, the current is flowing from right to left. And when power was connected here, the current was flowing from left to right. So the change in the direction has given you the minus sign. Now, when you superimpose, means when you add both of them, you are going to verify the result, right? So this is how, I would say, this is how we were able to get the experiments done, give hand, I won't say exact hands-on, because when the students tend to connect the wires and all those voltage sources into the circuitry, then it gives them a entirely different type of an experience. But to some extent, we need to generate that particular interest so that student can connect the theoretical concept to the practical concepts. So likewise, I think Dr. Maheshwar, should I stop?
Yeah. I think, please.
I will just wind up in a minute. So this is how, so likewise, I would recommend, promote all my students. By the time you are coming, all these are readily available on the web, right? Go to the website, go to Google, type virtual labs and try to identify how you can get benefit, how you can use these platforms which are available. And by the way, we are trying to develop our own virtual lab platform for the Siemens Center at BMU, right? So very soon we will also be having our own virtual lab platform, with starting with few experiments into that list. Dr. Dwivedi, just
yeah. One. So
yeah.
So thank you from my side. Thank you, Dr. Anubhav, and appreciate your desire to engage and motivate the student community to improve the electrical visualization skills. I'm sorry that I will have to, because there's a lot of pressure on me to close the session, because we have already overshot our time. And I'm extremely sorry, I won't be able to give an opportunity to my last panelist. I'm sorry, but thank you all for joining. And it is indeed heartening to note that the virtual labs have been instrumental in keeping our students' curiosity in learning different new technologies. But at the same time, I always feel that this new norm would remain with us for a long time to come, where students would get an opportunity to experiment by themselves. That is the flexibility that the virtual lab would bring in. And we all know that necessity is the mother of all innovation, right? So this pandemic has pushed all of us to the online world, whether knowingly or unknowingly. But I believe that humanity has always trumped over this pandemic. As we all embark on this new, but yet some kind of an evolving journey in this new norm, which is the online education. So thank you all for joining this session. If there is any queries for our panelists, please feel free to put them up in the chat box. Okay.
Maheshwar, sir, the students are asking about class strength. So you could say that about class strength.
How many, you would like to take this, because this is about coding.
Yeah. Okay. So I generally hear class strength is of 60, but due to online, we would like to pay attention to each and every student. So large groups are 30 in each group, right? So that we can handle each and every student's query.
Any other query?
When does admission close for upcoming students. I guess Abhinandan has.
Abhinandan, you would like to join in here?
Yes, sir. So, admissions closing date, again, as I said earlier, the dates are not finalized yet, but definitely we'll release this date officially on the university's website, you know, very soon. And for more information, you can connect with your counselor.
Okay, so there's one more student. Can we have offline classes, you know, after September?
Yeah, so the idea.
I think that would be a very difficult question to answer right now.
I know that, but I just want either Dr. Dwivedi or Abhinandan maybe. That is not in our hand. Teachers are more, willing to.
More than you, we would also like to come back to our classroom.
But I think Dr. Dwivedi, I think whatever the experiences all the panelists have shared, these students would certainly be eager to use these virtual lab platforms, because absolutely. I think this is something very new. This is something which I am trying to use it more and more, because again, as I said, whenever you are doing anything in the hardware for us, the biggest challenge and the fear is about that what is going to happen to the circuitry, is it going to get burned or high current is going to flow and things like that, right? So that is something which is getting very, very easily compensated here.
Right. So the idea is that, the whole the new concept of, technology, we have known this technology for a long time, but we have been, shying away from adopting them in our classrooms. But this opportunity has come to us in a big way. I think this is going to help not only the online teaching, but also once students come back for offline, regular face-to-face classroom. This will continue to remain.
Yeah. There's one question every student is asking about to discuss about the laptop configuration details. So guys, that depends that how much, space you want. But I just say that these days we are in i7 processor. So you may, if your pocket permits, you can go for i5 or i7 processor. And today is the era of AI and ML world. These are buzzwords and every student does that kind of a deep learning and AI application. For that you need GPU, so you may have buy any laptop, maybe a Dell or Lenovo or could be anything, but that should be enabled with GPU. So that would be
So Dr. Kiran, I guess i5 with an SSD would be good enough.
i5, but these days if I need I need AI applications, so I'll prefer to have i7 processor with some NVIDIA graphics card, which will help me to have these applications which consumes a lot of processing computation.
So your recommendation, students would use your recommendation to push to the i7.
Really sorry to interrupt, but I think, sir, we have a hard stop at 4 o'clock. It's already 4:01. Okay. Yeah. So there's another event that needs to take place on this platform.
Okay.
Abhinandan, thank you. So
thank you, everyone.
Thank you all for joining. Thank you all for joining in this very interactive session. Thank you all.
Abdul, you can-